Who'd like to pray? Somebody like to just ask the Lord to speak to us tonight or today.
Go for it,
Rick. Go for it.
Heavenly Father, thank you that you have gathered us in your name. Lord, we want to give you praise and thanks for all of the heritage that you have put before us as testaments of and examples of faithfulness. We think of our dear brother Kong, who is he's in your presence, Lord, and we give you praise. We also pray for his dear wife Dora, who is yet with us, and Lord, we pray just a touch for her. Lord, we thank you for the God of all comfort that you carry us, Lord, when we can't even walk ourselves.
Jesus.
And so we just worship you, Lord. Father, we thank you that your word is not bound tonight.
Amen.
We pray that you will give our brother Bernard an open heaven, just complete liberty in the spirit to share as you have worked in his heart, Lord, and that we would have ears to hear what you would say to us as your people in these days. Lord, our heart's desire is that you would teach us to pray in these strategic days that we're in, that we might bring much glory to you, Lord. We thank you that in our various assemblies, Lord, you are doing a work. And Lord, may we be found faithful. May we run that race that is set before us. And with nothing looking back, we're just forward in faith, looking to you. We give you the praise for what you're going to do. Bless each one that is with us tonight, Lord. Father, this is a time that you've ordained that we can all hear tonight. And so, Lord, we thank you that you do satisfy our hungry and thirsty hearts, Lord.
Oh, Jesus.
We give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we're just at the moment in a place called Boyle, B-O-Y-L-E, right near a place called Carrick-on-Shannon, which is on the River Shannon. And we're among a mixture of Ukrainian people from Nigeria, people from Tanzania, people from Ireland, and they're just beginning to meet. So it's a fresh work. I've not met most of them before. So we had a gathering this evening and several tomorrow and then Monday as well. So you can imagine church issues are coming up in their hearts, you know, and of course it's always a privilege just to speak of the Lord's and the wonder of his church, and so reviled and so much confusion about the church. You know that Jesus only mentioned the word ecclesia twice by direct statement, only twice. Both occasions in the Gospel of Matthew. Once in chapter 16 and once in chapter 18. Only two direct mentions using that word, which you know has something to do with, you know, the Greek words for call and the Greek word for out. So some people talk about it and the inference being the called out ones. And I'm sure most of you know that's the inference that is usually mentioned. And I sometimes wonder if Jesus only used the word ecclesia those couple of times, with its sort of emphasis on called out, because so much of what he did mention about the church, and never using that word, he uses words like flock, and he uses words, of course, through his apostles, like body and bride. And, you know, these words that have the inference much more of being together, community, family, having the same origin, the same father. It's almost as though he doesn't want to emphasize the called out so much as the called together, the called together. And of course, that's because everything began together. You know, all things had their beginnings in one. And that's a tremendous thing to bear in mind. All things had their beginning in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And all things can only really be what they're meant to be if they are all living one in Him. So finding their place in Him, and the whole work of the enemy, divorce, you know, all the DI things, you know, all the negatives, all the things that spewed out of the wicked one, you know, separation, 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 division, 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 split, 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 isolation, 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 loneliness, loneliness, loneliness. Oh, it's amazing, isn't it? But this is why all things come together in Him. And you know the two references to church. You know, it's all really so simple. And if we take a brief look at chapter 16 of the book of Matthew, and see what comes together there, what comes together there. If the church is that which is brought together through our Lord Jesus Christ, through His bloodshed, through the work of the Spirit. If you see what's brought together in that chapter, see what God joins together, let no man put asunder. Now you will interpret that by its first meaning, when Jesus uses it, of course, of male, female, what God hath joined together. But the rule extends far beyond human marriage. What God has joined together, let no one put asunder. And I think that you will discover that error creeping into the church, error keep creeping in your doctrine, say of holiness or the gifts of the Spirit, or the eschatology, the second coming. Often error is where you don't keep together what God has joined together. And part of the blessed ministry of the Spirit is that, of course, He will keep in right proportion He will keep things joined together. He will connect them in their right proportions. So, for instance, the river that was in Eden, which broke into four heads, all one blessed stream, but breaking into four heads. And Paul mentions in, and this is very interesting, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, they were a distorted church. You probably know that, because they had set too much emphasis on power, and the power that they were espousing was not the right power. And some of them were emphasizing wisdom, the pride of wisdom. And of course, Jesus, when he is mentioned by Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, he says that Jesus is made unto us four streams: wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, redemption. He joins together because he knows it all flows out of Christ. And you'll find that you get things wrong. I get things wrong. And the enemy seems to me at hand, where possible, that when we begin to get something not fitly joined together, as far as doctrine and truth is concerned, he will, knowing our propensities naturally. So if you're a critical person, he will emphasize certain doctrines of correctness and so on. If you're a sentimental person, he will emphasize and make love a sloppy, sentimental thing. He will take advantage of your tendency and your personality and try and avail himself of and use it and emphasize it, so that there becomes a disconnect and things are not fitly framed together in the doctrine. Do you understand me? I hope you're grasping what I'm saying. What God hath joined together, let no one put asunder. Even this evening, driving back to where this place where we're staying, which is a bed and breakfast, coming back, there's a young Ukrainian lady, and we're able to speak to her, and she's asking questions. And there was a particular question troubling her, which she had asked at the end of the gathering tonight, and apparently I'd misunderstood it so and talked on things that she didn't think was the answer that I'd picked up wrong. So she asked me again, and so I had the opportunity. But it's all to do with a doctrine of Christian service that had become in a certain group of people and churches and pastors completely separated, divorced from its proper place. It had been made everything. Service had been made everything. Everyone was to be like the apostles. They were to give up their jobs. They were to serve. And these things, think about this yourself, as to, some of you will have passed through things in your backgrounds where what God had joined together had been put asunder, and some great emphasis had been laid upon one element of truth and turned it into an error. And you know, it's not by chance that the Lord in Matthew 16 is talking to the religious. And the religious, it's remarkable how they can get their eyes fixed upon the wrong thing. And Jesus is talking to Pharisees and Sadducees, and they'd come to test him. And you know how he answers them. They were seeking for signs. There shall be no sign given, as Jesus answered them, than the sign of Jonah. That's what he says, and they don't quite grasp what he's meaning. A man alive from the dead, that's the sign, a whole man, not a boy, not a baby, but Jonah came out of the mouth of the fish, and he was a man, and he prophesied, and he spoke the word of God. And that's the sign, Jesus said. And of course, we know that it refers to him. The man child is born into the world. Tremendous thing. You know, tremendous. Jesus born into the world. And you know, of course, as you look down Matthew 16 here and come to verse 5, you find that, of course, the disciples, you know, the disciples are confused by Jesus. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees. He says, now don't be like them that are laying the stress where it ought not be laid. They've got things divorced from one another. They can read natural signs of the heavens, but because of the distortion in their thinking, because they haven't got things fitly joined together, they cannot read the signs of the times, the signs of why is Rome the powerful force it is? Why are the children of Israel locked up in bondage and under the yoke? Why? They're not reading the signs. They're not seeing that in their own history, they had been under the yoke because of sin. They had not been a free people because of their sin, because of their idolatry. And when I think of this, you know, I think of the blessed privilege of being God's people. We should be Demas Shakarian, all those years ago, the man who started off the Full Gospel Businessman's Fellowship, the happiest people on earth. I think he wrote a book. Some of you remember it, maybe. And, you know, in a way, that's who we should be. Not under the yoke. And if we're under the yoke of a bondage, if we're under the yoke of an empire, a power, we should be examining ourselves. We should be why is this, Lord? Why is this empire holding power over me? Why am I in the bondage to a kind of perpetual misery? Why is it? Because that's not your inheritance, brother and sister. you know. And you know, the Pharisees couldn't read the signs of the times. You know, to think of what's going on in the churches today, the false liberty that is manifest in many quarters, it's not true liberty at all. And to read the signs of the times, why? Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing if the powers that be, humanly speaking, in the United States were saying, why are we like we are? God, show us. Why? If they were beginning to inquire and say, seek God about the signs of the time. Why is it like this? Why is this? And the Lord would begin to speak. When, you know, no one comes through to the wisdom of the just except through utter honesty of heart. An utter honesty of heart means meekness, seeking God's face. No one comes through. It's the only kind of heart that bears fruit. It's an honest and good heart. So even the disciples are confused, because when Jesus talks about beware of this leaven, of looking in the wrong direction, of missing the point, beware of it. And dear disciples, well, he's talking about bread and all the rest of it. And no, I'm not. I'm not at all. I'm talking about the teachings. Avoid them. Beware them. Beware of the thing that lays stress on one thing and one thing only. And behold, it does injustice to other things. And some of you have been through this in the past, and you had to come out the other side of it, where things have not been joined together fitly. Well, having said that, then Jesus comes to Caesarea Philippi. This is verse 13 of our chapter. And in Caesar, and you recognize the name straight away. You recognize the name Caesar there, Caesarea Philippi. It's a headquarters, it's an honorific given to a city. And you could say it's a little bit like Jesus being in a local representative of the assembly, the chief of the assembly of the empire. And it's there, you know, the empire that's round about. We've talked about empire a bit before, but the powers that be. And I think it's good for us to remember this, that Jesus first mentions the church in the face of the pretentious assemblies of Rome. Everyone understanding what I'm saying? This great, massive kingdom, community, law, order, according to Rome. And in the face of the biggest manifestation to date in human history that we know of, biggest manifestation of the power of the wicked one moving through men to form a kingdom that shall not pass away. It's in that background that Jesus speaks about his rule, his assembly, his community. It's in that background. It's almost as though there is a challenge in the very place that Jesus asked the question. In Jesus never went to Rome. If he had done, I'm sure he would have asked it there. He would have stated these things there about his church. Let's say he had made a pilgrimage to Rome in the sense that the part of his journeys, he couldn't because he was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That was his place. It all had to be done there. But had he gone to Rome, he'd have said to his disciples, and he'd have spoken about his assembly and his greatness. You realize that it's all the challenge of greatnesses. You know, the voices that you have been challenged by have been great voices in your lives, you know, and they've challenged you. And the things that are happening, it's incredible when you think about it. And the enemy coming through various means. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, is or am? Who am I?" It doesn't begin with church. Now, I know that I might sound like a record stuck in a groove, but you will find so much teaching which starts with church, starts with doctrine, starts with Jesus, starts the whole conversation by I. And who am I? You know, our great malady, brothers and sisters, in the churches is to talk about the blood, what the blood does, to talk about salvation as a thing. Everything becomes things. Justification becomes a thing. Sanctification becomes a thing. It becomes something we believe, a thing we believe. Jesus starts with himself. And you, I know you'll miss it. We all miss it. You will go through the prophets and you will miss it for sure. But you will find God saying, "I am your salvation." Not the thing. I am your salvation. I am your life, Jesus puts it. You know, I, that's why Jesus starts the whole ball rolling, you could say, by saying, "Whom do men say that I?" And you brothers, when you preach, you know, I think I mentioned to you Oswald Chambers before in this regard, how he went through some personal dealings of an extreme sort in the brilliance of his mind that almost rendered him unable for anything. And he was a holiness preacher. Now, hear that, what I've just said. He was a holiness preacher. He was a brilliant minded flavor of the year or two or three holiness preacher, beloved by people, and he went through he was set up in meetings, he was, and he went through this thing that rendered him almost incapable. Do you want to know the quote? He said, "Nothing but the grace of God and the love of friends kept me out of the lunatic asylum." That's the quote. "Nothing but the grace of God and the love of friends kept me, the prayers of friends," I've got that wrong, "the prayers of friends kept me out of the lunatic asylum." A breakdown of mammoth proportions in a brilliant-minded young man. And you will discover that the great shift in his ministry was from the holiness preaching, that he became a lover and a preacher and a speaker of Christ. If you look carefully at his writings, you will find that he will not allow you to think about holiness or service or doing this or doing that or speaking in tongues or whatever. He will not allow you to think of those things apart from a living relationship and communion with Jesus Christ. It's all in him. How much living, quiet kissing of the Lord have you had today, where your eyes have just turned to him and your ears have just turned to him, and you've just been quiet at table for 5 seconds and looked and thought of him? You know, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" Who do men say? And so he challenges the apostles. He provokes them to some speech. And they've been hearing opinions, hearing voices, hearing. You know, some say John the Baptist, some others say Elijah, others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And they've been hearing things. Their heads had been filled with opinions. It happens to us all. Jesus is just getting them out into the open. Get out into the open. Jesus wants me out in the open. You know, and to confess, you see, well, and you've got all this speculation going on. Speculation. The church is not going to be built on speculation. It's not going to be built on your vague opinions that come out of culling a few scriptures out of a blessed book called the Bible. It can't be built on this, you see, the speculations. I listen to some, sometimes all I can stomach is 5 minutes of some of these recognized greats in young greats, some of them, you know, and I think, oh God, all I can hear is speculation. Opinion, speculation, opinion, speculation. That's all I can hear. I don't want to mention any names. They're in the charismatic field. They're in the emergent church field. And if you strip down all their words, I tell you, you've got a bunch of speculation. And, you know, you can't build a church on that. Only a social society that gathers round an idea of what church is. That's all you're going to get. And Jesus then, having heard their remarks, Jesus says, verse 15, "But who do you say that I am?" Who do you say? What's coming up from your gut? What's coming? I'm not asking you whether you're holy or whether you're right or whether you're this or whether you're a good Jew or whether you're of the sacrifices or you know that you're a good disciple of mine. What is coming up from your gut about me? That's really the nexus of the question. This is the gravamen of what he's talking about. What are you saying? I mean, I had a lovely conversation with someone the day before yesterday. Haven't seen him for 30 years, I guess. He has been through such a hell, a mental hell. Not a physical hell. It lasted 7 years. Imagine. 7 years. And I'd heard about it. And we were just standing together and I said to him, "Now, just tell me a little bit of how you began to come out of it." And he said to me this, he said, "I was standing mute, staring into space, really, just utterly lost, utterly lost. And as I stood there," and I'm going to use the word, he didn't use this word, "I had a mystic moment." I used that word. He used the word, "I knew that God was there with me. I knew." And it's as though I felt his hand on my shoulder for about 2 minutes. And I knew, and I was healed, that I began to heal. I knew. Hallelujah. That's it. This mystery. Who do you say that I am? He knew that God was God. God was God. I put out the little notice, on an itinerary that we just put out. And I spoke, and this is vital, brethren, because this is what the church, this is what humbles the heart. This is what breaks your heart. This is what will deal with your uncertainties. The ones that slay you won't remove all, but this learning to live where you know and live from where you know. It's beyond believing. You know, you've got your three sets of Johannine writings. You've got John's Gospel. You have got the three epistles of John. That's the second thing. You've got the book of the Revelation. Those three sets of his writings. Everyone got that? The three of them. Do you know the most repeated word in John's Gospel? Believe. 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 That's John's Gospel. Do you know the most repeated word in the three epistles? Know. K-N-O-W. We know. And the most repeated word in the book of the Revelation, worship. That's the great theme of the book of the Revelation, the worship that flows from those that know. Hallelujah. Do you know? Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And I think of what I wrote recently. You know, the book of Job. They did not know. Job did not know that Satan had been up there before God, getting permission to do some things. Job did not know. Did not know. It was hidden from him. We know, but he didn't know. And you know what happened. And you know the blessed quietness of the comforters for a while. But they could not resist opining philosophically, theologically, doctrinally. They had to have their say. And God allowed them to have their say. And they had their say. And their say provoked Job's say. And so they're embroiled in the vortex of argument. When I think of Rick praying earlier at the beginning about that the Lord would help us to pray, you know, that some fruit of what we're doing here, I tell you, your kids need to know God. Don't just get them to pray the sinner's prayer in an emotional moment. I tell you, your children, be sparing. But above all that, pray that they'll know God. And God is so brave. So courageous with his man Job. God knows his man Job. And so you can imagine them, the amount of time poor Job sat on the ash heap. Can we imagine it? Can we imagine it? And the friends offering their, and the voices. So you've got the voices, you've got the voice of Job and the voices of the three, and then the voice of the false Eliphaz, who hasn't got much more to add, but he seems a little humble, which the others do not seem to display. And therefore there's a little more quality in Eliphaz, the false comforter. He's young, but he's humble. And so he seems to have something more to say. But it's still, you come to this blessed thing. The words of Job were ended. The words were ended, and the words of these men were ended. Glory to God, finished. And then the amazing words, aren't they? Then God speaks. God speaks. God starts to, and you know what? God doesn't answer anything. He basically says, I am. He basically says, I'm here. Were you there when I was doing this, when I was doing that? And Job is comforted. He knows. It's not explained. He knows. I notice one or two of you nodding, you know, because you know what I'm talking about. He didn't answer, but you just know. Excuse me for saying someone was in touch with me this week, someone I've known since she was a little girl. I think she's in her mid to late 30s now. She's a married woman. And she asks me about baptism. She's a naturally retiring personality. And she said, I'm in this church and I have felt for months that I should be baptized. And she said, but I was baptized when I was 18. But I just feel that I should be baptized. And she's asking and she poured out one or two other details. And I wrote back to her and talked to her a little bit about just the whole business of what was it like when you were baptized? She said, I was 18. I just was following my peers. I didn't know anything. I was just copying them. So, and then she says, I don't know a lot of doctrine. I don't know a lot of this, that, and the other. And I've got to fill in all the forms in my church, and I've got to get all the answers right, and so on and so on. And what do you think? And I wrote again and said, well, just tell me, why has this come up? Where are you? And she said, I don't know much about justification and sanctification. Then she wrote this, but I know my life is hid with Christ in God. I questioned her about it. How do you know? I just know that I know where my life is. And then I wrote back to her and I said, I cannot tell you whether to be baptized or not. I said to her, but as you're quiet before God, you will know whether you've been baptized or not. So she writes back to me and says, couple or 3 days later, I know I've never been baptized. I said, well, you better get baptized then, didn't you? It's all this way that God deals with you and me. In the realm of the gut, the inner man, it's much deeper than an intellectual thing. That's why Jesus is getting them beyond speculation. He's getting them beyond believism. And he's saying, who do men say? What's coming up out of your gut, Peter? And this is what comes up. You are the Messiah. You're the one. You're the one. The Son of the living God. Are you seeing these words? Are you seeing who he is, what he confesses? We talk about Peter's confession, you know, as to what Christ is, but do you see the words he chooses? You're the one. You're the one. Messiah. You're the one, the promised one. You're the one. You know, this is way beyond, well, you love me, and you're the one. This is what the church is built upon, you see, because Jesus is going to say that a few words further on. He's going to say, this is what the church is established upon. This is the rock. You're the one. You're the Messiah. You're the Christ. The Christ. The Son of the living God. Do you notice that Jesus says, who? Who that I, the Son of Man, am. Is that what he says? He says the Son of Man. Look at it. And then Peter says, you're the Son of the living God. So you've got Son of Man. You're the true man. You're the true God. You're his Son. And he's the living, living, living. Excuse me if I seem to be so the living God, the spontaneous God. God is the living spring. God is the well that never runs dry. With joy shall you draw water out of the wells of salvation. What and where are the wells of salvation? They are not in heaven. They are in God, in his depths. That's where it all is. And with joy is that Isaiah 14, I think. With joy shall you draw water. It's the living God, fresh, ever fresh. You know, you're the Christ. And then Jesus says, he says, you know these words, we've gone over them so often, you have heard them so often. Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, the man who hears. You know his word, his name means hearing. You've been hearing right. You've been hearing right. You've been hearing right. Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who's in heaven. You know, I do love the way the Lord speaks these things. Oh, you're blessed, you're Simon. You know, to have ears that hear. Ears that hear. You're blessed. Mr. Hearing. Mr. Listener. Mr. Attentive One. Son of John. Grace. Son of grace, you're so blessed. Flesh and blood didn't show you this. My Father who's in heaven, heaven. You know, I always think of this, you know, with Jacob. I always think of that rock and that oil. I didn't know that God was in this place. Remember when he woke up from his dream? He'd seen the ladder up to heaven and angels of God, up and down, connection. That's the church. Yeah, when you come together tomorrow morning, those of you in California, those of you in Canada, when you come together, you are the doorway of heaven. You're the place where Christ the ladder is. Live like it. You don't need any accoutrements. You don't need flashy things. You just need this Christ in your gut. Who he is. Son of the living God. You need, don't remonstrate with yourself. Don't, you and I need a deeper, deeper, deeper knowing of who we are because of who he is. You can pray for the sick and they will recover. You can speak the word from heaven. You can have his presence in the midst of you. Flesh and blood's not revealed it unto you. That's a lovely word, isn't it? Revealed. It's a lovely word. Glory to God. The bedroom we're sleeping in has got blinds, you know, and French blinds. And we let them down, and we'll let them up tomorrow morning, and we'll reveal what sort of day's out there. We'll see it, you know, and there, I know that there's an increasing revelation that comes to us day by day, but there are occasions when you are stunned with the beauty of Jesus, with the greatness. You see him, you know him. Cry for it. Just show yourself to me, Lord. That profound knowledge in the deeps, this is what the church is built upon. Recently, I've had to say to a man, we've been waiting for you. Your uncertainty has been affecting everyone. You must either get clear or get out. And see what will happen. It's got to happen. Got to happen. And you see, and hallelujah, he's wrestling through to that place of, and I have to say this to you. Church begins with the letter C. You can't have church without the crucified life. Can't have it. And sometimes it's the unwillingness to embrace the cost of the cross that impedes the growth of the true church. The life of Christ spreading itself through every member. The life of Christ spreading itself through your life. The life of Christ must spread through your life, brother, sister, my life. The life of Christ must spread up into your mind, into the every fiber of your thinking. The life of Christ must spread into the length and breadth and depths of your heart. Your emotions, your affections, the life of Christ must fire your will. He must fill you. Must fill me. And that involves the cross. That involves the cross. Flesh and blood has not revealed it to you, but the Father's been working in you. Isn't it wonderful? Have you ever sat for 5 minutes and just thought, Father, I'm where I am today because you've been revealing things to me. You've been revealing your son to me. It's amazing. And you know how Jesus continues his speech. You know the words as well as I do. And I tell you, you are a little stone. And on this rock, I will build my church. You're a little stone. And on this rock, I will build the church. What my Father's been showing you. And I suppose I could emphasize in saying these words, I will build my church. Or I could emphasize, I will build my church. Or I could emphasize, I will build my church. Or in some cases, I should emphasize, I will build my church. Mine. Because you know, ownership of the church is a big deal. You know that, don't you? Some leaders think they own it. No, you don't. No, you don't. My church. Mine. My beloved bride. You do some thinking about these things, and you will well know on this rock. This rock, revelation from the Father of who Jesus is increasing in your heart will form rock in you. It'll be rock in you. It really will. And you know, the powers of death shall not prevail against it. Oh, that's right. Powers of death shall not prevail against it. This rock shall not be removed. This solidity in your heart. Glory to God. I love it. I love the way that ultimately, you know, you're stripped back to what do you know? What's coming out of your gut? Live by it. Will you do that? And he goes on, doesn't he? And I'll give you the keys. These people have got the keys. People like this have got the keys. That's the thing. You know, if all you've got's the Bible, you haven't got the keys. You know, it's the people in whom the revelation is. They've got the keys. They unlock understanding in others. They unlock light to dark hearts. You know, those who've gotten beyond themselves, those who know that this is Christ in them, it's God in them, they're the ones who got the keys. You've got a church like this, that prays like this, that lives like this, that knows like this, that is in the revelation like this. You've got the keys. Pray boldly. Pray boldly. Pray for one another boldly. Encourage one another boldly. You know, stop listening to the voices of the false comforter. So just theologize. You know how Jesus says, you know, about binding and loosing. You know, binding and loosing, binding and loosing. Glory to God. I tell you, there's something that's got to go on. You know, there's a loosing that comes to people. You know that. You know, some of you men, may I speak to you. There is a releasing of the anointing from within you. Stop looking for anointings to come upon you, but let that which is already in you be loosed in the will of God, so that the anointing is released in you, and it will not be something that in any way promotes your self-aggrandizement. It will not. It will promote the must. I must be about my Father's business. I must. I must pray for the sick. I must talk to that person. I must. It's this anointing that looses you from those things that bind. There's a binding, there's a loosing. The church is, this is its realm. Binding, loosing, binding, preventing. I when I look at this binding and loosing, sometimes I think of binding of hearts together. There's a power there, but there's also a binding of things, the powers that have been at work, Masonic curses that are in families, occult things, people who've been tied up with the occult in their younger life, and still the veil of those effects. There's not enough prayer, there's not enough deliverance ministry going on, because there's not enough certainty. You will come into a place of illumination increasingly, and the Lord will bring people your way, and you will pray the prayer of faith, and deliverance will be granted to those who've had a veil come down. They did the Ouija board, they went to fortune tellers, they did this, that, and the other, and they wonder why they seem to be veiled and just unable, and Masonic connections. They may never have been Masons, they may have been children of Masons, other secret societies, and so on. And when a man goes under those coverings, he takes in his family too. And they have to be loosed. They come to the Lord and they need to be loosed. This is the region of the church's ministry. It's graphic, I know. Some of you from Malaysia who are on this morning, for you will know more about this. It's more out in the open. But in the West, it's there. In more subtle forms. But this is our currency. This is our currency. This is my currency. This is why I'm speaking. This is why I'm, you know, this is my realm. I was in a shop yesterday and talking to a lady. I've spoken to her before. And I go into that shop when I'm in that particular town, and I see the veil upon her. I see it as plain as day. I know. And at this point in time, the Lord hasn't granted an opportunity to pray with her. She doesn't know the Lord, hasn't got a clue. But it'll come. It'll come. Hallelujah. Now look at verse 21. From this time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders, chief priests, and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. You'll have to be killed, brother. You say literally? No, you know I'm not talking literally. You know, but I'm talking about we got to be killed. That's what you see, from that time forth, from the time that he uses the great C word, church, he has to start talking about the second C word, cross. Cross. What did I say about men like Watchman Nee and Norman Grubb and Austin Sparks and Stephen Kong? And we happened to be mentioning them earlier. They had the mark of the cross upon them. That's it. Have I got the mark of the cross? That's the thing. Or am I still self-indulgent? From that time forth, Jesus began to show his disciples. Show his disciples. Show. That's what leadership in the church is all about. You're showing. I'm showing. Showing. You know, Jesus, from that time, oh, you say, well, it means he's just talking about it. You know, he's just and so on and so. I was showing it, and they understood it later. They understood that almost every day was a lesson. Almost everything was a lesson, an example. Blessed Jesus showing the way of Calvary. Don't you love John's gospel in that regard? Just the cross. Of course, he didn't call it the cross, did he? It's his way of life. Surely you know that the crucified life, you know, is not the crucified life. It's just his way of life. It's God's way of life. Hallelujah. I was at a meeting this morning with old friends I haven't seen for 30 years, and they were speaking about their ministry in Africa. You know, and as we parted, I was able to say a few things to them. And they got the mark of the cross about them. Do you know, she was a year or two after they got married, she went out, she was in her mid-20s, he was a little older. And they've been out there 30 years. And all you can hear, I was so thrilled to listen to them, and just all you can hear is give. They've just given themselves to those people in that country to which the Lord sent them. Just given themselves. And what have they received? Pressed down, running over, blessings all around. They ain't got a nice house and this, that, and the other, but they've got the cross. But, you know, I think probably if I'd have said to him, well, was that the cross? He said, yeah, but we, yeah, of course it is. It's, you know, that's what they call it, you know. But Jesus doesn't call it the cross. You see, the Father doesn't call it the cross. It's the way of the life that you've been baptized into. This is the rock of the church, you see. Yeah. Dear, dear, you know, he's got to suffer many things from elders, chief priests, scribes, and be killed, and the third day be raised. And oh, where do you lay your stress? You know, suffer many things from this and that and the other and the other and the other. On the third day be raised. They got the resurrection, those friends of mine, this morning. I could hear it, you know, and it's wonderful. And then what do you think? What do you think? Dear old Peter, eh? Dear Peter. Oh, God forbid, Lord. Peter took him and began to rebuke him. Now, you can understand a little bit like this, can't you, with Peter? Because after all, he thought he'd just been given the keys of the kingdom, you know, and had great sort of power. So he thought he was almost he could give Jesus a bit of advice. God forbid, you know, and it took him and began to rebuke him. Can you imagine this? Can you imagine it? Have you given it a go? Well, I have to be honest and I have to say, without explicit words, but in attitude, I've given it a go. I've said to Jesus, well, that's a bit extreme, Lord. You're putting me through this. Now, lighten up, will you? And it's been rather difficult. I've been confined to barracks for about 3 years. I'm not doing anything much and this and that and there was something. Or I've heard that or this has happened and the other. And, you know, you give God a little bit of advice. You begin to rebuke him. For his ways with you. And you know, you've probably read the other accounts in the other Gospels. Jesus turned and looked upon the disciples, one of the other versions says. I think it's Mark. Jesus turned and looked upon the disciples, and then he rebuked Peter soundly. For the sake of others, you're leading the others astray. Your example's not right. You're abusing that particular leadership that you have, Peter. And for their sake, get behind me, adversary. Or how do you pronounce the word? Adversary or adversary. Get behind me. You'll find them in your church. You'll find at least one who's an adversary. Oh, may the Lord preserve you from having a wife who's an adversary, or a husband who's an adversary to the way of the Lord. You can still go on. Imagine, he turned and said to Peter, get behind me. It's the only way to put it, brethren. You know, when you hear these things in your mind, in your heart, the word of the adversary, heed the word of Jesus. He says to it, get behind me. That's what you must say. You have to put it behind you. You have to put it behind you. You're a hindrance to me. You're not on the side of God, but of men. I mean, isn't this naked? I mean, I'm sure that many of you see it very, very much. You do not mind the things of God. Your mind's wrong. Lord, have mercy on us. You know, in these days, and then you go through the rest of the chapter, and I'll just jump to number one, C was the church. Number two, C is the church, is the cross, the crucified life. Number three, C is chapter 17, verse 1. The coming. Jesus takes them up the mountain, and behold, they see him in a transfigured way. Jesus says, some standing before here who will not taste death, verse 28, before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Church, cross, coming. See the Son of Man coming. Oh Lord, I see you coming. I see you are high and lifted up. I see you transfigured. I see you in glory. I see you. Amen. I'm going to leave it there. That's Jesus's first reference to the church. Do you know where his second reference is? Chapter 18, same gospel. I said to one of the brothers from a church represented here, he was writing to me a little bit about gossip. Gossip in the church, gossip. You know, and gossip is disruptive. And I said, Matthew 18. Oh, I've done that before. Soak in Matthew 18. You don't know anything about the church at all unless you know it's the community of forgiveness, where you're seeking the lost lamb, where you're all like little children. Read Matthew 18. Soak in Matthew 18. Elders, soak in Matthew 18. You won't make so many mistakes with people. Heavy-handedness, rushing in too soon. Viewing one another with tenderness, seeing that lambs are lost, sheep are willfully lost sometimes, and an unforgiving spirit is the root of gossip. You'll see this in the church, is a community of forgivers. That's Matthew 18. It's a community of becoming as little children and entering into this realm of God. Take your time on it. You know, we had a dispute in a church that we were involved with very intimately a long while ago, before it was ever brought out in public. I spent a good 6 months musing in Matthew 18, just seeking to understand. Oh Lord, a sheep had gone wrong, and how to deal, how to work, and this divisive thing that was working in the whole congregation. And God came amongst us in the end. But it's wonderful, wonderful. The church is heaven on earth. It should be. Should be. A glimpse of heaven. Now don't get sort of disappointed about this. Don't let your prayers be kind of laced with cynicism or anything like that. But just rejoice yourself that you can live in the millennium, at least yourself, more and more. And then maybe you'll find that others will join you there. And glory to God, and who knows what will happen. Glory, and that. Well, I've said enough. I'm pleased and thrilled with the loveliness of Jesus and his will for us all. For you and me. I'm very thrilled.